controlling it already? Yeah, wir brauchen die erste Hälfte. This is die zweite Hälfte der Bilder. Okay, I'll go with the flow. We'll just start with it. Is that okay? Okay, it seems that I don't have a contact over there. So I'll show them very quickly the picture. These are caricatures from the time of wars and revolutions and crises, and it will be juxtaposed with pictures that people drew after they had perinatal experiences, after they experienced the different stages of birth, and it would illustrate what I said on Friday about the work of Lloyd de Moss and so on, who studied the speeches of demagogues and military leaders prior to the onset of war. There was an abundance of figures of speech and metaphors related to birth. So here you can just see how frequently the fetal symbolism is used in political caricatures. And these now are pictures of the going into the first stage of birth, where people experience vortex or experience of being swallowed or going into the underworld. So this is from a high dose psychedelic session, another psychedelic session, the whirlpool, experience of engulfment of different people from holotropic and psychedelic sessions. This is the experience, you know, when the uterus starts contracting, the fetus is losing the safety of the womb. And now these are some pictures from a political crisis. Engulfment. This is American lifestyle being swallowed by OPEC. Does anybody see a light at the end of the tunnel? The bush seeing the way out of the tunnel in the shape of Vietnam. Now these are from different times, you know, different historical period. So far, so good. Three different ways, all of them going into the underworld. You're here. Another one, another you are here. Now the dragon is a common image in psychedelic sessions, where it represents, you know, the elemental forces of birth. It's also the hero's journey. So it appears in many of the fairy tales, where a dragon is guarding the feminine and also a treasure, and defeating the dragon, then one has the hero's gamos and having a transcendental experience. You can see the size. He is in his claws. He's crashing crushing people. So this is from a psychedelic session. Another one from a psychedelic session. Here is Great Britain losing Hong Kong, the Chinese dragon swallowing Hong Kong. Communism represented as a dragon. Now, spider is another important image. One of the things that we can experience in the first matrix is a sense of sort of cosmic freedom, spatial freedom, you know, being in the universe, unobstructed universe. If you imagine a butterfly or a fly, the whole world belongs to them until they fly into a spider web, and then the spider comes. So the spider is like a symbol of the devouring feminine, very, very frequently associated with the second matrix, the stage of birth when the uterus is contracting, but the way out, the cervix is not open. So these are all this is a holotropic session, for example, another holotropic session from the holotropic training. This is from a psychedelic session. And here are the political counterparts, Saddam Hussein as a spider, arachnophobia, another arachnophobia. Now this is from a Soviet journal. This is Zapadnaya Evropa, means Western Europe. So this is American capitalists bringing atomic weapons into Europe in the form of a spider. Again, American capitalist as a spider. Now this is from a psychedelic session showing the female reproductive system as a kind of a combination of a prison, torture chamber, and gigantic press. Again, this from a sequence of a death rebirth experience, being crushed by this boulder with human features. This is Hans-Rudolf Giger's self-portrait with a poster for his exhibition. And now these are the parallels, the vice titans, the screw titans. Now the squeeze really starts, the grip on Lithuania, crushing again, choking, Carter choking, the financial crisis. Now, octopus would be a specific, archetypal danger for the oceanic freedom that the fetus has in the womb. So when the delivery comes, it can be experienced as something like an octopus, frequently a python, something that constricts and crushes and chokes. Now, these are the political analogs. This is Tsarist Russia threatening Europe. Oh, didn't like this one for some reason. Osama bin Laden as an octopus. Japan as an octopus threatening Dutch Indonesia. Carter in trouble. Slobodan Milosevic as an octopus. Zionism is an octopus. Uncle Sam is an octopus. You can see it happens across the board, you know, it's not limited to a specific nation or a specific time. Pax Britannica. Now this is from a psychedelic session. And this is a political cartoon parallel. In the Salvador cartoon, there were snakes, whereas in the previous one, there were predatory birds. So I'm just showing that predatory birds are also shown in that kind of a context. Snakes are very much involved in the negative perinatal matrices. The viper as a symbol of imminent death, but also initiation, because the second matrix is part of an initiation. It's the dark night of the soul. So people sometimes have a sense of being in a snake pit, very much like in Indiana Jones, the Raiders of the Lost Ark. Okay, you can see how this is all from psychedelic sessions. Birth as a fight with a python. Yeah. Similar kind of a situation. The pythons are very typical perinatal symbols because they swallow the prey and they look pregnant. They also twist the body around the prey and crush. So not every snake is what Freud thought it was. It was always phallic. This is from pre Second World War Germany. Genosse hilft mit zusammen bezwingen wir sie. Comrade help, together will defeat them. Conflict between the Nazi Party and the Communist Party. Stamp them out. This very specifically talks about snake pit. You know, Uncle Sam in a snake pit. Snake pit. Indira Gandhi, Marshal Tito, it goes back in history. There's a minister responsible for energy crisis. And this was Theodore Roosevelt and his political enemies, and he's represented as little Hercules fighting these pythons. Swallowing again, engulfment, crushing. These are Lloyd de Moses' captions. He's a psychohistorian. Now here the heroic figures here is Germany, Italy, and Japan, and the miserable creature here are the allies. It depends on who's painting these posters. This is one of the recent ones when they asked Condoleezza Rice about the mess in Lebanon. She said, as far as I'm concerned, these are the birth pangs of a new Middle East. Now, we talked in my lecture on Friday about the relationship between birth and nuclear development. I talk about the nuclear testing and the explosions of the atomic bomb and development of atomic bomb and all the messages around it, having babies are being born, parents are expecting and so on. Hydrogen bomb was Teller's baby. So these are some pictorial parallels to that. Saddam Hussein pregnant with atomic weapons. This is a sign for atom, the intersecting ovals there, and sitting on an atomic egg. And this is quite unbelievable, presenting Saddam Hussein as a bad mother, nursing atomic weapons. And here even stranger, as an enemy of children, somebody who can constrict and choke. And here you can see the opposite, calling for leadership as, show us the way out of the tunnel. This is a birth experience in a holotropic session, and this is Clinton's political victory. And this is Paula Jones accused Clinton of sexual harassment and got him into a lot of trouble. Here she is basically sending him, through this journey through the sewage system, and he emerges with a halo and then ends up as a kind of beaten up fetus. In our training, I usually show it juxtaposed with a wonderful cartoon, somewhat naughty by Robert Crumb, which is called Pete the Plumber, and we'll show it in the seminar on Monday. Here I have just this. And This Lloyd de Mos brings some evidence about the history of the military banner. The first documented banner was in ancient Egypt, and it was a dried placenta and umbilical cord of the pharaoh that was being carried into the battle. And Lloyd de Mos links it to the pictures of fetuses when they hold on to the umbilical cord. So something like a symbol of safety and also union and so on. I show this in Santa Barbara in the Pacifica school where I teach. And that was adult education, and there was a woman who said, I showed the whole slideshow, and the woman said, now I understand what my 16-year-old daughter has been drawing, and she sent me one of this girl's paintings. Again, the connection between violence and birth. Yeah, okay. So I show this sometimes at the end of this. I gave a talk in Moscow on my 70th birthday, and there was a banquet, and there were some people from the Ukraine, and they say, you keep talking about these perinatal matrices, but when we are coming from, babies are not being born from vaginas, they are being born from cabbages. And this was a 70th birthday present. And I have one last one that I usually show after a perinatal show, which appeared in the San Francisco Chronicle after Bush made his idiotic statement about the intelligent design when he wanted American schools to teach creationism, that the universe was created 6,000 years ago and so on. And he wanted, the same time to be given to this kind of idea, the creationist idea and evolution. And so this came out in the San Francisco Chronicle when he says, and according to another theory of human reproduction. Okay, so that's all. And now I would really, ich brauche nun was also der erste Teil der Diapositivschau sein sollte. Kann ich das bitte haben? Okay. So, I will not. How many of you were there for the Friday talk? Or how many were not? Okay, quite a few. I will not repeat these things. I was asking people, how many of them had non-ordinary states of consciousness of this particular category. Then specifically asking, maybe I'll ask here, how many of you had experienced the breathwork, the holotropic breathwork? Okay. So Lucius promised that he will bring more of those announcements, where the different opportunities will be experiencing holotropic breathwork if you want. And Theo Steiner just gave me the people who would be interested in holotropic breathwork in Switzerland. They both went through our training and they have been doing this for years. So those of you who would like to try it and compare it with psychedelics, you would have the opportunity. I understand people asking about tomorrow. We cannot do the breath work. We need at least a weekend for that. So this will be a theoretical lecture, but there will be tremendous emphasis on images, kind of a right hemisphere. And we'll sort of explore the symbolism and go through the whole psycho-spiritual process of death and rebirth. Okay. I talked about my first experience that sort of brought me into this, and how after my first experience the study of these non-ordinary states became really my lifetime passion. I talked about the work that we have done with psychedelics, with working with people in spiritual emergency. And then also the holotropic breathwork, and then how my interest took me to other areas where there were non-ordinary states, you know, going to shamanic cultures, doing ceremonies with natives, working with people who had near-death experiences. We had a study with cancer patients where we used psychedelics to induce mystical experiencing and studying how that takes away the fear of death and transforms the experience of dying. I was very interested in connecting with Tibetans, with yogis, with the Benedictine order, which are, you know, Christian mystics and so on. But the common denominator of whatever I was doing the last 50 years always was going for the, you know, different versions of these non-ordinary states, or the subcategory which I call holotropic, which are those that have therapeutic potential, which have transformative potential, and I believe even evolutionary potential. And then I showed some of these pictures again. I think it's very nice to bring Albert here for a little while. So this is the picture where he, at the time when he discovered LSD, which was shown all over the world. This was about 10 years ago, a visit with him. Now this is Anita, who just recently died. And this additional person here is Christina, for those of you who don't know her. And we just happened, during this visit, we just happened to run into Robert Venosa and Martina Hoffman, wonderful visionary artists. And this is, we brought Hans-Rudi Giger to the Hoffmans, and they became really good friends. And Albert admires Hans-Rudi Giger because, you know, he has amazing ability to capture the dark side. There's nobody like he managed to map the cartography of the bad trip, the second matrix and third matrix, as I call it. This was a time when Hans-Rudi Giger allowed us to use the upper floor in the museum. I understand that would be an expedition to Gruyère to see Hans-Rudi's museum. I really recommend it. It's amazing, amazing art. So we had lunch in Gruyère, and then Hans-Rudi showed Albert his gallery. You can see the size of these pictures, these paintings. And this on the right side is Carmen, she's the wife of Hans-Rudi Giger. And we had a panel where they represented really the two opposite sides of the psychedelic experience, you know, Hans-Rudi being the absolute master of the dark side, and Albert these days is in a place like a great Indian guru. He now sort of talks about the incredible laboratory that goes into the colors of flowers, and he's interested in the chemistry that goes into the color of butterfly wings, and appreciating that he's living in paradise, you know, watching every sunset and so on. So it was kind of interesting to hear them, you know, see them interact, and at the same time they get along just marvelously. So saying goodbye, and this was his 100th birthday. Okay, we covered all this. Okay, so I mentioned that Suni ordered this book that I called Psychology of the Future, and these are now the different areas in which we would have to change our thinking in psychology and psychiatry when we work with non-ordinary states of various kinds. So the first area has to do with something very fundamental, which is the model of the psyche itself. I call it cartography of the psyche. In other words, what kind of experiences are germane to the human psyche. What kind of experiences people can have without getting an ST diagnosis from psychiatry. Now, currently, we have a model where the psyche is somehow limited to postnatal biography, what happened to us after we were born, and the individual unconscious, which is a derivative of postnatal biography, rejected, repressed, forgotten things. And according to Freud, the newborn is a tabula rasa, is a clean slate. There's nothing that would interest a psychologist that precedes birth, including birth itself. Though Freud, for a very short period of time, considered that maybe all anxiety can be traced back to birth, but then he let it go and actually got into quite a conflict with Otto Rank. Otto Rank kind of, you know, caught the ball and ran with it, and very secretly worked on a book, The Trauma of Birth, that he handed to Freud fresh from the press on Freud's birthday. And Ernest Jones, who is the main biographer of Freud, described that Freud went into a state of emotional shock after reading Rank's book. And the reason why that happened is that he believed that it's possible that posterity will see Rank's contribution as being more fundamental than his own contribution. And, you know, and finally, after working it through a little, he issued a very positive statement that, you know, this is very important work, and it's important second only to the discovery of psychoanalysis by himself, and that people should, you know, the therapists should study people born with cesarean section, difficult births, regular births, and so on, and see the impact that it has on the psychology of these people. And then he started getting letters from Berlin when they were warning him that this is a very dangerous doctrine that's going to split the homogeneity of the psychoanalytic movement. Some psychoanalysts will be excited about it, others will reject it. And Freud finally surrendered to the political pressure and excommunicated Rank. Now, the work now that we were doing with psychedelics and breath work and rebirthing and, you know, other methods really are supporting Rank's idea that birth is extremely important, and there certainly is a powerful record in the psyche. The usual argument that you hear about this from neurophysiologists is that there couldn't be any memory of birth because the cortex is not myelinized. Now, which is kind of ridiculous, because memory is not limited to the cortex. Memory exists in, you know, animal species that don't have any cortex at all. Several years ago, Eric Kandel got a Nobel Prize for studying memory mechanisms in a sea slug, aplysia. So, you know, sea slug has a memory, but a newborn does not have the capacity to record something as overwhelming and life-threatening, and potentially life-threatening as birth. So it's important now to incorporate this into the cartography. And I call that level perinatal, which means related to things that happen immediately before birth, during birth, and after birth. It's quite amazing if you think about it, about that logical inconsistency, that there is a general agreement among psychiatrists that the early nursing experience are all important. They can really shape the personality and so on. Aristotle Sullivan wrote about the baby who is being nursed being able to distinguish good nipple, bad nipple, good nipple, evil nipple, and wrong nipple. Good nipple is a nipple that gives you milk. Evil nipple is a milk is one that, well, the good nipple gives milk and things are great. The mother is a loving mother, holding the child the right way and so on. evil nipple gives milk, but the circumstances are lousy. It's a rejecting mother, or the mother that's nervous, anxious, and so on. And then the wrong nipple is, either the thumb or the big toe, and doesn't give any milk. And then he has, you know, far-reaching speculations how that influences the development without recognizing the importance of birth. So you're asked to believe that the fetus can go through this horrendous experience that can last, 20, 30, 40 hours. Forceps might have to be used. The child might die and have to be resuscitated. Doesn't notice that anything strange is happening. It's not recorded anywhere. And then instantly after birth emerges into the world as this connoisseur of female nipples. Circumstances are not quite right here. Mommy's not holding me the right way. So if the child didn't notice that something strange was happening when he or she was being born, it's going to take a long time before the child will recognize nuances in the circumstances of nursing. So then I recognized, as I was working with people who are reliving birth, that the experiences were coming in these four experiential clusters, each of them having specific emotions, specific psychosomatic feelings, and also each of them represented a kind of a specific opening into the collective unconscious, either historical, or karmic, or mythological. So the perinatal level really is a mixture of experiences that are replay of what happened biologically in birth, but also it's all mixed up with archetypes. And we'll see the images tomorrow when we are going to be discussing that specific symbolism. So I talk about these clusters as basic perinatal matrices. Or BPM. The first one is associated with the situation of before the onset of birth, when the child is still in the womb. The second is the uterus contracting and no way out, the cervix is not open. The third matrix, very specific kind of combination of experiences, then the cervix open, then we struggle to be born, and then the fourth matrix, the actual coming out. And then beyond that, the cartography also has now a level that we call transpersonal, which includes experiences of oneness with other people, experiencing group consciousness. In psychedelic sessions, you can experience yourself as all mothers of the world, or all children of the world, or all soldiers of the world, and so on. Very, very vast kind of experiences, or even identify with the field of humans, species, all together. It can take you to the animal realm. You can have experiential identification with anything from primates down to unicellular organisms. And what's important, getting new information about each of those experiences of identification with these other life forms that is way beyond anything that you know from biology or some NOVA programs or some other sources. So what's involved in transpersonal experiences is a radically new it's an alternative way of getting to know the universe. The usual way is through senses. We have sensory perception. We analyze and then synthesize the information that came through the senses, and then we make a conclusion about the world. This is a radical alternative where we go into a holotropic state of consciousness and we learn about different aspects of the world by becoming them. By becoming other people, by becoming animals, by experiencing ourselves as a plant, and so on. Now, this is the basic message of many esoteric systems. You find it in Tantra, you find it in Kabbalah, you find it in the Hermetic tradition, the idea that each of us is a microcosm that somehow contains the whole universe. Now, this is, of course, considered to be absurd, nonsense by traditional science, you know, violating, among others, Aristotelian logic. So, what are you? Are you part of the universe or are you the whole? You have to make a decision. Now we got a way of looking at it scientifically since the discovery of optical holography. When we talk about us being the whole universe, we are talking about information. We have the capacity under certain circumstances to experience ourselves as any aspect of the universe. And what materialistic science is interested in is something else, which is what you can weigh and measure. So if I experience myself as an elephant in a psychedelic session, that doesn't mean if you put me on a scale that you're going to get 3 tons. You know, it's going to be substantial, but not 3 tons. So those are sort of complementary aspects. When we talk about transpersonal experiences, we are talking about getting information. We are not talking about objects. And so, optical holography is the holographic model of the universe, an amazing, amazing model for mystical experiences, for transpersonal experiences in general. So what these experiences are telling us is that everything that we can, in the ordinary state of consciousness, which I call, by the way, hylotropic, hyle means matter, and trepein means moving to, so consciousness oriented towards matter as a counterpoint to holotropic, where we have the experiences that take us in the direction of our wholeness, reclaiming our cosmic status and so on. So everything that we can experience as an object in the ordinary, in the hylotropic state, has in the holotropic state a subjective counterpart. I can see a sequoia in my ordinary state of consciousness. I can become a sequoia in a non-ordinary state of consciousness. Okay, so this is the cartography. So it's as you can see, this is a vast expansion from things that are limited to my postnatal biography to the idea that my psyche, in a sense, is commensurate with what Jung called anima mundi, that my individual psyche is teased out of this cosmic matrix and that the boundary is not absolute, that in non-ordinary states it can be transcended. I can become sort of other aspects of the universe, and ultimately I can go all the way and identify with the cosmic creative principle itself. This is the essence of what you find in the Upanishads. The question, who are you? It's tattvam asi, thou art that. You know, your true nature is not nama rupa, name and shape. Your true nature is they would say atman brahman, but it could be the Tao, it could be a great spirit, it could be Allah, the cosmic Christ, whatever name we want to give it. Okay, the second large area where we would have to change our thinking in psychiatry is in relation to what I call architecture of emotional and psychosomatic disorders. Again, if you look at academic psychiatry, if a problem is not organic, if it's not biologically determined, it had its origin in postnatal life. And there's this map that Carl Abraham made where you can link different emotional problems to stages of libidinal development and stages of the development of the object relationships. So I think I already referred to it in this earlier talk. Let's say the manic depressive disorders would be, and suicide would be linked to oral phenomena. Obsessive compulsive neurosis to the anal stage of development, hysteria whether conversion hysteria or anxiety hysteria, phobias and so on, would be related to the phallic stage. And then in ego psychology, borderline psychosis, narcissistic personality, those would be problems in early differentiation of object relationship, but it's all postnatal. Now, if you work with holotropic states, you will always find something in your history, postnatal history, that is meaningfully related to what you are working on, whether it's emotional symptoms, psychosomatic symptoms, interpersonal problems. You always find meaningful connections to your history, but it doesn't mean that it's all there is. If you have a method that can take you really deep into the psyche, you will discover that the same problem also have a deeper root. Like if you have claustrophobia, it will take you certainly to birth, tendency to violence, migraine, headaches, asthma, all those things have definitely perinatal roots. And even that's not the whole story, because in a typical symptom, you will find transpersonal roots. So there's a layered, what I call a coex system of condensed experience, which lies behind or underneath the symptoms. And the deepest roots are reaching into the transpersonal. They're karmic, they are archetypal, they are phylogenetic. So this normally would be a very discouraging discovery. You know, we thought all we have to do is to work on our postnatal history, and suddenly the playground is immensely larger. But the positive news is that you also discover new and very powerful mechanisms of healing and transformation on the perinatal level and the transpersonal level, which is something that's not known, not recognized by academic psychiatry. So on the one hand, birth leaves a repository of difficult emotions and difficult sensations that can develop in connection with postnatal experiences into various forms of psychopathology. But on the other hand, reliving birth, bringing the emotions and the pent-up energies to the surface and processing them, can also positively influence a number of different emotional and psychosomatic disorders. And then there are powerful healing mechanisms related to the transpersonal level. So for example, I've seen many, many people really resolving difficult phobias and depression, psychosomatic disorders of various kinds, like asthma, in connection with some powerful past life experience, or what they experienced as something that was coming from another century, from another country, from their karmic history. Very frequently, emergence of some archetypal material can have tremendous healing consequences. And the energy, the archetypal energy, sometimes can be demonic. We see a number of instances where people have to really deal with kind of energy that is personified, that appears evil. And when we encourage the emergence of that energy, it just, the whole thing looks like an exorcism. I have in the book, When the Impossible Happens, a story which I call The Interview with the Devil, that experiences a really full-blown emergence of a demonic archetype, just completely took over the patient and lasted a couple of hours, and ultimately ended up a tremendous healing, like, you know, some of the most fantastic therapeutic consequences I've ever seen after this kind of a very, very strange experience. It's not easy to understand rationally. And then there's the healing mechanisms of the healing mechanisms. It's the experience of oneness, the experience of cosmic unity, when we have a sense of becoming one with other people, one with nature, one with the universe, one with the divine, that is a potentially very, very powerful and transforming experience. Unfortunately, in current psychiatry, you would get a diagnosis for it, and if they get hold of it early, you would get put on tranquilizers, because we don't have a category, a mystical experience or a spiritual experience. So every experience of this kind would be seen as expression of pathology. And the reason for that is that we don't have a way of accounting for it in the conceptual framework that we are using in psychiatry. So these are these amazing healing mechanisms. And then there are some mechanisms which are absolutely bizarre. I have again another story in the book. There's actually a category of, you know, unorthodox psychiatry. And this was a situation where a woman came to our SLN 5-day workshop, and she had a depression that had lasted, I think, 4 years. And every time she got up in the morning, she couldn't get going. It took her 2 hours before she really got to move. And she, in the breathwork that we were doing, had some powerful birth experiences, linked the depression to difficult birth. But then the final resolution came when she felt unresolved, and we put her in the middle and wanted to complete the experience when the rest of the group was assisting. And she finally ended up chanting in a very emphatic way, a repetitive chant, kind of a prayer, and it lasted for a very long time. People around, you know, in the group, they felt very moved. Some people started to cry, some people were going into a lotus position, and nobody knew what was happening. She was there, you know, in an extremely sort of emotional state, chanting something that none of us understood, and then finally lay back, and it was just in ecstasy. And there was a psychoanalyst from Buenos Aires who came to us. He was Jewish, and came to us and says, "This is incredible. Do you understand what happened?" We said, "No." He said she was chanting in perfect Sephardic, which is a medieval, you know, Spanish Hebrew kind of a mixture, like what you have between German and Hebrew, and it happened to be his hobby. Synchronistically, it happened to be his hobby. And so we said, "What was she singing?" And he said, "She was singing, 'I am suffering, and I will always suffer. I am praying, I am crying, and I will always cry. I am praying, and I will always pray.'" And somehow, you know, doing this kind of Sephardic prayer for a significant amount of time resolved her depression. We saw her several times later, and the depression didn't come back. So it's not easy to find a psychiatric handbook where they would be talking about healing depression by Sephardic prayers. Okay. I don't understand to this date what it was about, but there are things that happen, you know, which are very extraordinary, very, very unusual mechanisms of healing, like that, the one that I call Flora, where the demonic archetype came through, or this one where it was about the Sephardic prayer. Okay, the next one is very important. It has to do with strategy of self-exploration and psychotherapy. Now, we have this enormous number of therapeutic schools, and none of those schools agrees with any other about some most fundamental things. As I mentioned earlier, and you know, what are the major, most important motivating forces in the psyche? Why do we have symptoms? Why do symptoms develop? What do they mean? And then each school comes with a different technique that you learn to work with your clients, basically to correct their psychological processes in a way that your school tells you. But the problem is this phenomenal lack of agreement. So you can, it's really arbitrary. I mean, you have a problem, you can flip a coin, you choose a school, and each school gives you a different explanation of what's wrong with you, and each school asks you to do something else. You might be getting interpretations that would be completely different in different schools for the same thing. And most of us are not even sort of surprised by it or bothered by it, you know, that sure, we have some 50 schools, you know, of psychology, and you know, if you're a beginning psychologist or psychiatrist, you just choose a school. We have no criteria about the quality, what's the hierarchy, which of them are better, which of them are worse. So our choice is absolutely personal. Like for me, it was Freud. Wow, that's where it is at. This is, you know, this is where I'm going to get my training. And this is what we do. And if it doesn't work for us, then we go and get a training in another school. I usually tell this story from my own psychoanalytic training. I was in psychoanalysis, training psychoanalysis for 7 years, three times a week, you know, a lot of money, a lot of time. And I loved every minute of it, to find sort of, you know, the symbolism in my dreams, and every slip of the tongue had some profound meaning. You know, if you ask me, you know, did it change you? I would say, well, I changed in those 7 years, you know, but for me, there was no convincing evidence that whatever changes happened to me had anything to do with my free associating. With my first LSD session, I know I was going in the morning, one person, and somebody else came out in the afternoon. And there's absolutely no doubt in my mind that what happened to me had something to do with that experience. I couldn't say that about the 7 years of psychoanalysis. But anyway, I did it. And there were several young analysts who were, you know, being treated by the same analyst. He must have been in his maybe late 60s. And it was known about him that he kind of fell asleep once in a while, you know, during analysis, and you had to do something to bring him back into the process. Besides being analyzed by him, we also had seminars with him when, you know, he got the assignment to report about psychoanalytic literature, and we discussed case histories and so on, and we could ask theoretical questions. So one of us asked a purely theoretical question. What happens if a psychoanalyst falls asleep, you know, during psychoanalysis? If I keep free associating, does therapy still continue? Does it require a fully awake psychoanalyst? Now, he couldn't say, you know, this kind of thing doesn't happen in psychoanalysis. I mean, he knew, we knew, so we had to do something with it. So he said, yeah, I mean, it can happen, you know. Sometimes you are tired, you're recovering from a flu, you didn't get enough sleep and so on, it can happen. But if you are in this business for a long time, you develop this sixth sense, you fall asleep only when the stuff that's coming up is irrelevant. And since when something important, you know, comes, you wake up and you're right there. And he was a great admirer of Pavlov. Pavlov talks about the inhibition of the cortex, and then he talks about the waking point. Like if you're a hypnotist, you can sort of go through a waking point in an inhibited cortex. And one of his examples is a mother who can sleep through heavy noises, but when her own child starts moaning, she has this waking point, and, you know, so she wakes up right away and attends to the child. It's just like Pavlov's mother, you know. Well, you know, it's a little different. It would very much depend on what kind of analyst you would have. Had I had an Adlerian or Rankian or Sullivanian therapist, they would have fallen asleep or waked up, you know, different parts of my narrative, because what's relevant for one school is not necessarily relevant for another. Now, the other thing is the therapeutic result. You see, we believe that we can use our intellect to understand the psyche in general and the psyche of the client in particular, and that we can come up with a was a technique to change that. And a lot of the therapy, it's about interpretations. Now, if there are such differences between the schools, it means people get different interpretations for the same kind of problems. And we don't have any statistics that would be showing that one school is superior to another. Now, if this were true, that intellectual understanding of the psyche and right kind of technique, right interpretations with proper timing are the factor in therapy, we would have to have a distribution on a Gaussian curve, when one school would have to have the most accurate intellectual understanding, as a result of it, most effective therapeutic technique, get all the good results, and the other schools that depart from it would be on the descending branches of that Gaussian curve. That doesn't happen. You know, the people who looked into this found out something strange, that the differences are actually inside of the schools, not between the schools. You can't prove that one school has, you know, significantly better result than another, but what you can show is that within each school there are better therapists and worse therapists. And very likely the results they're getting have nothing to do with what they think they're doing. They're very likely factors involved that you cannot even formulate in scientific terms. Like something like the quality of the human encounter between the client and the patient, or the feeling of the client of being unconditionally accepted by another human being, which they didn't have in their own history, or, you know, feeling of being important and so on. So what is the alternative now? What do these non-ordinary states teach us about the strategy of therapy? Actually support very much something that Jung formulated, and that is, it's in principle impossible to use your intellect to understand the psyche. And the reason for that is that, you know, for Jung the psyche was cosmic. It's not something that's inside of our skull. It's not something that's produced by the brain. The psyche is cosmic, anima mundi. And we partake sort of in this large cosmic matrix. There's a wonderful quote in Les Miserables, Victor Hugo. And this quote says, there is one spectacle which is grander than the ocean, and that's the heavens. And there is one spectacle which is grander than the heavens, and that is the human soul, the human psyche. So what can we do? So according to Jung, what you can do, you can create a kind of a protective environment. He was very interested in alchemy. So you can use the image of the alchemical vessel where the transformation happens. And then within that context, you give some methods that makes it possible for the conscious ego to communicate with a higher aspect of the client himself or herself, which Jung would call the selves, which when we do it in English, we would use capital S. In German, all nouns are capitalized, so it wouldn't work. And the healing happens in an interaction between the conscious ego and the self. And the interaction happens through symbolic language. Now, Jung himself didn't need any psychedelics or didn't need to do faster breathing. I mean, he was, at times getting more than he could comfortably handle. I mean, his psyche was very, very open at times. And then in his work, he was using active imagination, which is... Instead of analyzing the dream from the night, he would ask the patient to lie on the couch and let the dream continue. So he wanted to see the process in kind of statu nascendi as it was emerging. But the same principle really applies to the use of some very powerful methods like psychedelics or the uh, the breathing. So we create a supportive environment, like in the breathwork, we pair up people, everybody has a sitter, people alternate, and then we have trained facilitators who go wherever something, you know, really unusual is happening that needs some special attention. And we're sure that, you know, people do it internalized, we do it in a place where we can make noises, but there are not noises from the outside that disturb the process and so on. Now, once people get into a holotropic state of consciousness, then something like an inner radar gets activated that finds the places in the psyche where there is relevant material, okay. Which means material that has a strong emotional charge. And that material emerges spontaneously. So it is the inner healing intelligence, you see, that presents the material, what comes first, what comes next, what comes today, and what's going to have to wait for next time. And we as facilitators, we have to adjust to it. It's like almost like midwifery. We have to support whatever is emerging. So if we, for example, would do a holotropic breathwork session, you know, with this group, you would see probably most of the things that I'm discussing in the cartography, but it would be very individual. Somebody would be, after the same introduction with the same music, would complete something with the death of their father. Somebody else would be experiencing sexual abuse. Somebody would be reliving birth. Somebody would be having past life experiences. Somebody would have archetypal visions or experience of oneness and so on. So the process itself would determine. Francis Wong described what defines a transpersonal therapist. And she said the transpersonal therapist is defined by the context, not by the content, which means the transpersonal therapist has a big cartography of the psyche. The content of a particular therapeutic hour or session is given by the client, what comes up from the client, whether it's talking or whether it's some kind of experiences. And the context, I mean, the therapist has to have large enough conceptual framework that you can follow the client wherever the client goes. You know, you cannot say, well, I specialize in postnatal biography, or I just do rebirthing, or I just work with past lives. You have to sort of be prepared to work with the whole spectrum, because it's not your choice what is going to emerge. You have to shift. You have to be, you know, where the client is. So Jung called this to be a co-adventurer. You know, he said something like, you know, I still write books and try to put things in categories, but I know if a new client comes, it's a new ball game. He said something can happen in the session that nobody has ever seen, that you cannot learn from any books, because it's not in any of the books. The psyche is infinitely creative. So that kind of a process then becomes a learning process. We learn as well as help being sort of facilitators for the clients. Okay, what have we next? Spirituality. So again, in traditional psychiatry, which is very materialistic, and again, you know, I'm sort of talking as if all psychiatrists were the same. I mean, I'm pretty much aware, you know, that there are many deviations, and, you know, particularly a lot of psychiatrists who might be playing the party line when they get into a staff meeting. They on the side. They do other things or hold other convictions, but there's a certain kind of a agreement in the academic circles. And the basic idea is this is a material universe. The history of the universe is the history of developing matter. The universe somehow created itself, and then life, consciousness, intelligence are kind of latecomers after billions of years of this evolution of matter, which is blind, passive, inert, reactive. And you know, these things happen as a kind of a fluke in an insignificant part of an immense universe that has billions of galaxies. So if you have this kind of a worldview, first of all, the existence is there's no meaning to it. There's no meaning in existence. And the other thing is there is no place for spirit, for spirituality. So if you are spiritual, there is a problem. I mean, you probably have not studied enough materialistic science to really understand what the nature of reality is. You're probably gullible, you are, you're superstitious, you let yourself be dominated by primitive magical thinking, you are into, primary process rather than secondary processes, as Freud calls it. If you have somebody who is very intelligent and still is, taking something like God seriously, then you would have psychoanalysis, then you have a hang-up from childhood. You're still carrying some infantile images of your parents and you're projecting them out there and making God and goddess out of them. And if you have spiritual transpersonal experiences, you get a diagnosis because there's no category, the mystical experience, spiritual experience. So there would be a tendency to stop those experiences and you get a label and you might even get hospitalized for these kinds of experiences. Now, when you work with holotropic states, then you will find out something very different. And that is that if you are involved in inner exploration that takes you into your unconscious, when the process reaches at least the perinatal level, but then certainly the transpersonal level, your experience would have a quality that Jung called numinosity. He loved that term. This comes from Rudolf Otto. He loved that term, to replace terms like mystical, spiritual, religious, and so on, because it's kind of neutral. The other terms have been used too many times in different contexts and are easily misunderstood. But what this means that it takes you into a certain realm, and you feel that this realm is radically different from what you know from your everyday reality, and built into it is a notion that it's actually that realm is supraordinated. So it's very much like what Plato was talking about. You see, there is this other realm where you have forms with capital F or ideas with capital I, and they form and inform what is happening here. So if you experience that archetypal world, archetypal figures and so on, it's very, very much like what the native cultures and the ancient cultures believed. Those are gods. I mean, Rick Tarnas, when he writes about it, he talks about three ways in which you can look at archetypes. One is the Homeric way, when they take actually the form of deities, Aphrodite, Hades, and so on. There is a way of looking at the archetypes philosophically, which would be like Plato. And then you can look at the Jungian way when they are seen as psychological principles, the organizing principles of the collective unconscious. Now, through centuries, there has been a discussion about the Platonic archetypes, about the ideas, whether they really exist or whether they are abstractions. These two schools were called nominalists and realists. The realist is not really a very good name for it, but the nominalists were saying, these archetypes are just names. They are abstractions for what we see on this level. The Great Mother archetype is really our abstraction of what we see in individual mothers, or the archetype of the tree is an abstraction of what we see in individual trees. And the realists were saying, no, they are real. There is a realm in which they have real existence. And they actually, influence of what is happening on this level. And the work with holotropic states very much sort of supports this the second version. I mean, when you get to the realm and the, you know, the great mother goddess would be as real as anything you can imagine or more. So we discover that there is this realm normally invisible that's supraordinated to this realm. So the clue to understanding spirituality is really the large cartography of the psyche. I mean, there would not be religions without people having had experiences of these other dimensions. Now, when a religion becomes organized, that is something very different. Then you can completely lose the connection to the spiritual source, and they can get completely dominated by secular concerns, politics, you know, about money, hierarchies, possessions, and so on, and also get in conflict with each other because they opt for other kinds of archetypes, and the differences can be enough, you know, for killing each other, or also differences within the same religion, the Shiites, the Sunnis, the Protestants, the Catholics, and so on. So transpersonal psychology really validates spirituality as an important, vital dimension of the human psyche and also the universal scheme of things, and is trying to show that there is no conflict between spirituality properly understood and science properly understood. Ken Wilber wrote in The Sociable God, there seems to be a conflict between religion and science, it's very likely bogus science and bogus religion. You know, they don't understand each other's position, and very likely they are not good examples of their own kind. Those are the kinds of things we have a Hubble telescope and we have mapped, you know, every part of the heavens. And nobody has seen any angels than God. We have disproved the existence of God. And of course, the realm of true religion does not compete with the material world, because the kind of concepts that you find in religion, like heaven, paradise, hell, and so on, those are related to states of consciousness. But to get to hell, you don't travel anywhere, you don't go down somewhere, you change your consciousness. You can be here and be in heaven or hell, where everybody else is in Basel, you know, those are not incompatible. The same kind of a pseudo-argumentation is like, you know, we now know what is under the ground, there's, you know, in the middle of the planet, there is liquid nickel and you know, liquid iron, and there's no place for the caves of Satan. We have disproved the existence of hell. And those kinds of people who have this argumentation are very, very surprised when they take a psychedelic session and you know, suddenly they are in hell or in heaven. So this was really first Huxley who pointed it out in his wonderful little essay, Heaven and Hell, that those are real, heaven and hell and purgatory, those are all ontologically real entities, but they are related to what you can experience in non-ordinary states. And you know, nobody who's just studying the material world is in any position to make statements about it. People like Dawkins, you know, the God delusion and so on, trying to prove from studying nature whether there is God or not. The only way you can make any relevant statement about spirituality, mysticism, shamanism, and so on, you have to study states of consciousness, because that is the discipline. You cannot make extrapolations from physics or from biology or from some other realms. So there is tremendous validation of the spiritual dimension. On the other hand, transpersonal psychology is not trying to bring together religious dogmas, you know, in organized religions with science. You cannot do it with Cartesian Newtonian science or new paradigm science. You have to study experiential spirituality. It's nothing unscientific, to study as the category of experiences that we all can have. What is their phenomenology? Are they ontologically real? What kind of influence do they have on people? Those are all, you know, very relevant scientific tasks. Okay, just very quick. I would like to give you today a chance to ask some questions too. So, you know, some of the most fundamental implications of this kind of work have to do not only with the theoretical framework of psychiatry and psychology, but the philosophy of Western science. This go against monistic materialism, against the idea that matter is primary and consciousness is some kind of a little Cinderella, kind of a, you know, epiphenomenon and so on. It's showing that consciousness is something very fundamental. Consciousness, you know, permeates all of existence. And I mean, if you are in some more advanced stages of this self-exploration, you can get to the point where it seems more plausible to you that consciousness can create the experience of the material world, rather than matter is capable of creating consciousness. You know, 20 years from now, when virtual reality technology is more advanced, we'll understand that just because you experience something, it doesn't have to be there, at least not in the form in which you experience it. And this is the whole concept of lila, or maya, that that the Hindus have. The world really is not, you know, what we experience in everyday life. The inability to see it is called in the Eastern literature avidya, which is ignorance, but very fundamental ignorance. Ignorance about who we are and what is the nature of reality. And it's one of the, you know, important functions of these holotropic states. It's let us make it possible for us to see through this, to overcome that. And that's called prajna paramita, transcendental wisdom. I'll just not describe it, but I just refer you to the particular to the experiment when in near-death situations the consciousness goes out of body, and people can watch the body from above and decide, consciousness decides to go check what's happening in other parts of the building or thousands of miles away. Findings that blind people, organically blind, when they get out of their body, they can see, and they have what Ken Ring called veridical out-of-body experience. They can see, or not only see, but what they see can be consensually validated by people who have the gift of vision. Okay, we have the last one. That's you know, subject that we cannot, we can barely touch. And that's the problem of astrology. You know, I've done this work for about 30 years with Rick, when we are looking at different states of consciousness and finding that there are astrological correlations, very systematic correlations. And that's where we started, and Rick then moved to historical research. His book, Cosmos and Psyche, you know, gives his basic thinking, but it's primarily focusing on history. But in the course that we teach on non-ordinary states, archetypal psychology and astrology, we, you know, show how that instrument can be used when you are involved in self-exploration. Just very briefly, in Esalen we found, to our tremendous surprise, that as I described the phenomenology of the different perinatal matrices, and we found out that if you read that, like the first matrix is you know, the baby still in the womb, it's an oceanic experience, it's a cosmic experience, a mystical experience, it's all archetype of Neptune. If you look to the other, to the second matrix where the uterus contracts, they tremendous pressures, no way out, and so on. It's depression, compression, you know, starvation, heaviness, all those things are Saturnian. And then the third matrix is when the cervix opens and there is the struggle through the birth canal, that's powerful energies. Birth is related to birth, death. There's a sexual element that comes from the choking. And then there's the biological material, elimination. This is all under the archetype of Pluto, if you read astrological handbooks. And the last one, the fourth matrix, the coming out, is experience of sort of unexpected resolution of a very difficult situation, breakthrough, overcoming boundaries, epiphany, flood of new insights, and so on, which all belongs to the category of Uranus. So this was really amazing discovery, because I had no idea about astrology at the time, and I was teasing this out of people's experiences. I was, you know, defining these four perinatal matrices by what people were reporting to me, what I was seeing. But then came something even more astounding. We found out that people actually have the encounter with those matrices in their sessions at the time when they have the transits of the corresponding planets. And then it became obvious that you can use astrology in a very, very meaningful way. You can do past research. If you kept, let's say, the records of the dates of your sessions, you can go and find what transits you had and see if it's true, if it was really archetypally predicted by your astrological transits. You can use it for planning a session. You can choose a particular, you know, particularly positive time for your session, or you can use it in the present when somebody is in spiritual emergency. We have never seen anybody having spiritual emergency where there wouldn't be some hard aspects of the outer three planets, four planets. And it correlates with the timing of the spiritual emergency, but also the content. The content, what people are experiencing, reflects the archetypes of the planets which are involved. Anyway, so as much as I can say about it in this context, again, we can go more into this tomorrow, and I just like to give you some chance to ask at least a few questions, because you didn't have it in on Friday. So thank you very much. Do we have some kind of arrangement here? This is a mic that people can use, or how do we do this? Shout? Okay, I'll try to hear. The mic is in the island, you say? Yeah. What?
Hello? Hello?
Yeah, this one's working. Dr. Grof, I have a question.
Please.
I'm a big fan of your work, and I've also become a big fan of Irvin Laszlo's work. I understand he's a friend of yours. Do you have anything you'd like to mention about this concept of quantum consciousness, or this idea that the mind and this universal field that's being increasingly described and discovered, that consciousness is an interaction per se between that? Because I've never really read much about that in your books, but Irvin Laszlo's books very much seem to lead in that direction. So I was curious what you had to say about that.
You know, Irvin Laszlo is a very close friend. We actually co-wrote one book, and he's my personal hero now. I had many heroes. First was Fritjof Capra with his Tao of Physics, and then Rupert Sheldrake with the new, you know, new science of life, and then Prigogine, and of course, you know, Gregory Bateson, and I think Irvin with his idea of the psi field, PSI, or what he calls now the Akashic field, That's, I think, the best model that we have currently. And so I'm in some of my recent writings, I'm actually referring to it. He has defined scientifically a kind of a subquantum field that he calls the PSI, the psi field or the Akashic field. And the basic idea is that everything that has ever happened in the physical universe is recorded there holographically, which explains many, many things. I mean, you know, in an LSD session, you can suddenly be in ancient Egypt, or you can be in the French Revolution, and so on. So the idea of this universal archive that, you know, he used the term that's used in a somewhat narrower sense in the Hindu tradition for karmic imprints, the Akashic field. That's the best model that we have so far. There were other works. For example, there was a paper by Walker who believed that the contact between the what we call material world and consciousness would happen on the quantum level. There's also the idea. There's now a very, very strange development which is called interdimensional communication. Have you heard about this? I'm still sort of working on it myself. It's a pretty far out concept. Many years ago, a Scandinavian researcher, Friedrichsen, studied the song of birds and was recording it in the forest, and came home and found out that when it was supposed to be silence between the songs, there were some voices. And he concluded that those were voices coming from the beyond. And then a researcher from one of the Baltic republics, Raudive, discovered that, and he continued this work and recorded I don't know how many thousands of these voices. And it was published, the book was published as Breakthrough, it's called Breakthrough, and there was actually a long playing record where you could hear those voices. And then nothing happened for many years. Both of them died, and now it came back with vengeance. And there's a group of people who do this ITC, interdimensional communication, where they believe that you see, on the level of transistors, it's based on the tunneling effect and the probabilities, where you cannot say whether the particle is really there or not, and so on. That's seen as an ideal interface between this beyond and the material world. And so they are getting supposedly pictures from the beyond, like on television screens or in the computers, and they get faxes. And I went to a lecture by Ernest Senkovsky, who is like the guru of this movement, and for 3 hours in Corte Madera in California, he was showing this the faxes and voice messages from the beyond. And what supposedly happened now, this Fredriksen and Raudive, they both died, and they are now trying to communicate from the other side. And they have an entity who is called calls himself Technician, and he is dictating what would be the best circuits and so on, how to arrange the devices for the best reception from the beyond. So I was pretty open when I was coming into that lecture, but it was stretching my imagination and certainly my worldview. So there's this is certainly you would be looking for the subquantum level if you want to find some kind of a connection between science and what we are studying. Okay, any more? Please. Can you use that mic, please?
Yeah. I was curious about the connection between the woman who was chanting in Sephardic, ancient Sephardic words. Did she have knowledge of that language prior?
Absolutely no. She didn't know what the language was, and she didn't know ordinary Spanish or Hebrew.
And did anyone record it?
We didn't record this one. We recorded in some of the breathwork. Sometimes, you know, people, one of the things that happened, people start talking spontaneously. Now, in some instances where we recorded it, they were talking in language that they didn't learn in this lifetime. In some instances, we would give it to linguists, but they were not able to identify it, which doesn't really say very much. You know, when Christina and I visited Australia, we found out that the Australian Aborigines have about 200 languages. And then if you look how many languages there are in Africa and in, you know, in India, or you take it back into history, how many languages there have already been. Even if the linguists don't understand it, it's, you cannot exclude it, that it is an existing language, because in some instances you can do that. I have a story there about actually my sister-in-law in that book, where she and my brother emigrated to Canada, and they had to support themselves and prepare for medical examinations. And so she was kind of sleep deprived, and she started hearing voices. She's a psychiatrist, so that's really bad news when you start hearing voices. But then it seemed that, you know, it was like a language and sounded like something Middle Eastern. And so she took it to a Sufi teacher, and he recognized it, and it was ancient Arabic, and it was some Sufi texts which were not published, which were just passed through, you know, oral transmission. And so he immediately sent her to Yugoslavia, to the higher level of the order, and then she ended up in Kona all the way. And you know, it was they told her that they were expecting her. It was just an unbelievable story. So you can hear these, that, you know, exactly what is gibberish, what is a language, you know, what is talking in tongues might not always be very clear, but there are instances where people really speak languages that they have never heard about, and you can show their languages. In other instances, it can go into movements. People can, you know, not knowing anything about yoga, they can go into perfect asanas, or do mudras, appropriate mudras, or the you know, we have seen when people started doing sounds which were exactly like the Kechak, the Balinese monkey chant, when they, a group of people represents the army you know, the army of monkeys that was helping Rama, that led by Hanuman. And again, we had in Maryland, we had a closed circuit TV, so people who wanted their sessions recorded, we had the recording. And so when some strange movements would come, we then could try to find out, you know, was this, when it looked very stylized, was this some kind of an art form from another culture? And in some instances, people would do dances from India, and sort of hand movements that take years to learn, like they are telling stories Krishna just in you know, digital symbols of various kinds. And in some instances you can confirm that, a person enacts a courtship dance of some other life form. Okay, let's take the last one, if anybody has a burning question.
Yes.
Okay.
Hi. I have a question here. My name is Lily, and I've been working with breathing work about 8 years, and finally with holotropic breathing the last couple of years, and soon to finish the GTT training. And this, having this background, this morning when I was listening to Alison Gray, just came to my mind, if you can have any suggestions about using holotropic breathing with children in order not to wait until you have a more advanced age and start to heal all your traumas, earlier traumas.
We ourselves haven't worked with, you know, with children specifically, but we have instances where children would come. I think the youngest was 10 years that we worked with. Couple of kind of amazing instances. One was we were working at Esalen in a place called Huxley, and we noticed that session after session there was little kids sitting in the window and just, you know, fascinated by what was happening. And he finally came and said, "Can I do it with you?" And his father was also at Esalen, and he had done it with us. So I said, "You know, go to your father, and if your father says okay, you come." And the next day he came, you know, with his own blanket sort of into the session. And a really great session. It took him all over the, you know, all over the world. At one point there was a lot of crying, where I felt very guilty, you know, because if it takes into bad places some adult people, they're willing to do it because they know they're working on some material that's sort of, in a way, interfering with their life, but to, you know, cause suffering of the little kid. Was a different story, but in the sharing, he just told his story, and when I brought up the crying, he says, "Oh, it felt so wonderful to cry." And you see that very, very frequently in the breathwork and other forms, that if you look at people from the outside, they're screaming, crying, and it seems like they're suffering, but actually they have the feeling that something is leaving their body. It's very different from the situation, the original situation, where they were exposed to the abuse or whatever it was, and they did not have the way of processing it. So anyway, so I talked to his father, and I said, "You know, the kid is really amazing, and he's an old soul." And he said, "Well, maybe it has something to do with what happened to him when he was 2 years old. Both parents were drug counselors, and the little kid got into their fridge and polished 10 pills of LSD, 200 micrograms each, they knew something about drugs, so they were smart enough not to call a psychiatrist, and they just held him through it, and you know, it was a quite a remarkable kid. So we had instances. We had instances like this, but there are people whom we trained. One is Brigitte Ashauer. She's from Wiesbaden, German. One was Marie Rivoir in France. I think she was from Rouen, and they actually worked specifically with little children, and actually even families. Now you have to get the kid interested in it. I mean, you cannot force them to do it, but if there is enough interest, children can certainly do it. And we had a lot of experience at Esalen when people were using gestalt with children, guided imagery and so on. Those kinds of things can be done certainly, and children love that kind of stuff. So it definitely can be done. Where is the probably most interesting, in the young generation, most interesting use is do it with adolescents. Because if you look at human culture, the puberty rites is probably the most important category of the rites of passage. All the pre-industrial cultures had one or another form of powerful rituals here. And people like Margaret Mead thought that the fact that we lost meaningful rites of passage really contributes to the kind of problems that we have with young people. And actually, many of the young people create their own rites of passage that are pretty, you know, dangerous, screwy, destructive, and so on. And so we had a meeting. Margaret Mead took about 20 of us into a castle in Austria, Burg Wartenstein, and there was a week conference about ritual where she wanted to explore whether it would be possible for us to design some rites of passage for this young generation. And we have some people who specifically worked with adolescents, and they just felt, you know, that this was really a very interesting way of using those energies that you see and turning it inside to a transformative process rather than having them acted out somewhere in an unsanctioned way. And we were this was like 1973, but maybe 10 years ago, Christina and I were invited by a New York legislator to a conference, and I couldn't go because I was teaching our training module. And Christina went, and they were discussing this. This New York legislator was desperate with the situation of the young people in New York State, but particularly New York City, in terms of drug abuse, promiscuity, sexual acting out, criminality. And whatever they were doing, these young people were laughing at them. And then he noticed that they had ritual elements in their behavior. For example, in Africa, in some of the tribes, if you come of age as a young boy, they give you a spear and you have to go and come back with a lion. And in these New York gangs, if you want to be in, they give you a gun and you have to go and shoot somebody in the street. Doesn't make a difference who you just have to get a stiff, you know. And then when they had also fights between gangs, and when somebody is killed, they have very elaborate ritual funerals. So somehow realized that there's some kind of a need for them for rituals. And the idea was, could we create something? Could we structure something to channel this kind of energy? And so they were discussing things like, I don't know if it's known in Europe, ropes courses. You know what that is? You go to a forest and then you create a kind of a complicated situation where you stretch ropes between two trees and you create platforms, and then people have to, for example, cross over from one tree to another way up there, supporting each other, and they have harnesses and their safety is guaranteed by the group, they holding the ends and so on. So it's used for team building and so on. Exposing people to various dangerous situations that can push buttons, outward bound, again dropping people somewhere on an island, like the survivor program in the television, and let them survive on their own. And they were talking about firewalking, which was very popular in California. We most of us have done it. And they were discussing the breathwork also, because there are no rites of passage without holotropic states, and psychedelics for the time being are out. So they were discussing creating some kind of a combination of this that the young people could go through. There are people like Malido Masome, who is African, who do men's groups, for example, very much like a very heavy duty rite of passage, where people end up, for example, buried up to their chin, overnight, and little things like that. So. Okay, again, I don't know if we got the last time we ran out of the announcements of the possibilities where to do the holotropic breathwork, if you're interested. But we have a website which is called holotropic.com, where all the events are announced there. I have also one that you might want to look at, or some of you, and that's my full name, Stanislav Grof, together, and then .com, and then slash like this, and index, and that's my personal website, and it has link to a website from the Association for Transpersonal Psychology. And it's called Stan and Christina Grof Photo Archive. which has just a lot of pictures from previous IPA conferences, from Esalen, and so the, you know, the whole history of the transpersonal movement, if you want to look at it. And, you know, there are many, many articles there, interviews, and so on. A lot of the material that you might be interested in.